Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ed Schwartz, and I'm going to be talking to you about some of the work we've been doing in the area of vulnerability discovery. So the goal of our project is actually to find as many vulnerabilities as possible. Now, you might think that's a bad thing, right? We tend to think of vulnerabilities as being something we don't want. But the idea is that if we find them, then we can either fix them, we can mitigate them, or we can choose not to use software that has them. So by finding them, we give ourselves more actionable information. So I'm joined on this project by my colleagues David Warren and Alan Householder from CERT. And we're also very lucky to be working with a great group of collaborators from formerly from campus, who've now started their own startup called For All Secure. And I'll tell you a little bit more about them in a minute. I'm going to be telling you about two different thrusts of our work. The first thrust is taking vulnerability discovery and trying to make it more of a science. And what I mean by that is actually creating evidence, finding evidence, that doing things in a particular way will allow us to find more vulnerabilities. Traditionally, a lot of vulnerability discovery has kind of been very ad hoc. You know, people have tried things, they worked, and so they just kept doing them. And we'd actually like to get some good evidence that, you know, we're doing things the best way. The other thrust that we're working on in collaboration with For All Secure is taking two different types of vulnerability discovery, fuzzing and concolic execution, and trying to fuse them together so that we get a more effective tool in the end. So first off, I'll talk about trying to make vulnerability discovery into a science. I'm going to be talking about mutational fuzzing, which is a type of vulnerability discovery, and it's a really simple idea. So the idea is that you start with seed files, which are just inputs to a program that you're interested in testing. And what you do to these seed files is you mutate them. So we'll talk about what exactly means that in a minute, but think of doing things that are going to change the file in some random way. And you take these mutated files and you run the program you're testing on them. And it turns out that even though this is ridiculously simple, if you do it fast enough, like thousands of times a second, you will actually find bugs by using this very simple process. It works a little bit too well. And that's part of the problem, actually. So I think one of the reasons that we haven't really been scientifically studying fuzzing as much as we should be is because one of the outputs we get are lots and lots of crashing files. So we might get, you know, 100,000 different files that crash the program we're testing. Okay, great. What do we do with those? What we actually want out of this process is we want to find the vulnerabilities in the product rather than this huge list of crashers. So part of our work has been trying to address this, trying to reason about vulnerabilities rather than crashes. And part of the challenge here is that it's kind of difficult to describe what one vulnerability is. If you've ever tried it, it's very difficult to do that and actually be precise enough to really convey what you're talking about. So we had a different idea. One of the things that people do fairly regularly is they fix vulnerabilities. So we thought maybe we can leverage the patches involved in the fixes to help us define what each vulnerability is. So the idea is if we have our program again, and we have some file that crashes the program, and we give this file to a program and ask them to fix the vulnerability, they can probably do that. And then when we take the file and we run it on the patched program, of course it doesn't crash anymore, okay? So the insight here is that if we were to take another file and it crashed the original program, but it didn't crash in the patched version, well, then we've just learned something. We've learned that it's actually affected by the same vulnerability that was fixed in that patch. So this simple observation gives us the ability to take each crashing file that we get out of fuzzing and then test it to see which vulnerabilities are causing that crash. And so what we get is what we call the ground truth data, which basically maps your crashing files, which I have here on the left, to the set of vulnerabilities that are causing them. And it turns out that we can do a lot of interesting stuff with these. Now, I've been talking about patches. So you probably download patches on your computer, on your phone. You know, we have lots of patches. But these patches that we use kind of on a daily basis for security updates aren't actually what we want. What we want are patches that fix one vulnerability at a time. You know, Windows updates and things like that, they tend to fix hundreds of different bugs at the same time. So we basically have to find and create our own patches. So what we did is we took an older program called Image Magic, which parses different image formats, and we fuzzed this using Search Fuzzer, BFF, for a week. And we found over 100,000 crashes. And then we sat down and we fixed all the vulnerabilities that we found in here. There were 31 vulnerabilities, and it took about a month, and it was not a very fun process. But now that we did that, we have this ground truth data. And so we can start answering questions about how we should actually be doing fuzzing. So some of the things we might wonder are, how should we actually do mutations? How long should we fuzz? Does it matter what compiler we're using? You know, should we optimize, should we not optimize? And it turns out there's a whole lot of questions. I'm gonna talk about some of the results that we have in this area, but feel free to stop by the poster, and I have a number of more figures that I can show you. But first I'll tell you about how should we mutate files. So I told you that in fuzzing, you basically take your seed files and you mutate them. Well, what does that mean? So one of the things we did is we have 9 different types of mutators that are built into Search Fuzzer, BFF. And essentially what we did is we set the fuzzer to use one of them and then fuzzed for a week. And we just counted how many vulnerabilities we found over time using each one of these different mutations. So the one at the top is called bitmute, and what it does is it mutates things at the bit level, so it's just flipping bits. And again, this kind of shows you just how simple fuzzing can actually be. Such a simple strategy can work really well, but it turns out that some of the other simple strategies don't work quite as well as bit flipping. One of the other problems we looked at was, how long do you fuzz? How do you know when you're done? So this graph is showing you the number of crashes that we found over time in an experiment. And you can see this is a really straight line, which is telling us that we're finding crashes at a steady rate. So this graph at the bottom is showing you how many vulnerabilities we find over time in the experiment. And notice that these two curves don't look anything alike. With the vulnerability curve, you know, we find a whole lot of vulnerabilities at first. We find like 20 vulnerabilities in the first day. Then we start to slow down, it gets a little bit more difficult to find vulnerabilities. And then finally at the end, in the last 3 days of the experiment, we don't find anything. And so having this data actually helps us a lot, because when we're in the middle of a fuzzing run, we can look at how long it's been since we've found the last 2 vulnerabilities and try to guess, you know, where on this curve are we? You know, are we done or should we keep fuzzing? And so that's an example of some of the different kinds of information that we've been able to gather by generating this ground truth and mapping crashes back to their vulnerabilities. So now I'm going to switch and talk about a different part of the work we've been doing in collaboration with For All Secure. So For All Secure is actually a relatively recent startup company that originated out of Carnegie Mellon in Dr. David Brumley's research group. And these are the 3 founders at the bottom of the screen, Dr. Brumley, Dr. Thanasis Saviernos, and Alex Robert. And I actually worked with these guys quite a bit. I was in this research group as well. And I can tell you that they're really experts at different types of binary analysis. So one of them, which I'll be telling you about more, is conchoic execution, which is a type of vulnerability discovery that's pretty exciting. But they're also very interested in automatic exploitation, which is basically about trying to make vulnerability discovery, particularly advanced vulnerability discovery, sound, meaning that you actually have actionable information after you're done with it. And one of the nice things about this collaboration is that there's really a nice fit with some of SEI's historic expertise, which has been in fuzzing. And as you'll kind of see, these two techniques are very complementary, and so it really makes natural sense to try to combine them. So what is conchoic execution? I'll show you an example. So this is a kind of just a snippet of a program that is parsing an image. It's reading some rows, a number of rows and a number of columns. It's allocating some memory, and then it's doing some writing. So conchoic execution comes from the terms concrete execution, which is basically just running a program as normal, and symbolic execution. So we start with concrete execution. So here, if we start with a file that has rows 0, columns 0, we'll just run the program and kind of see what happens. And that's when we start doing symbolic execution. So with a symbolic execution, we look at the path that concrete execution takes, and we create what's called a path predicate that essentially adds all the constraints that are required to take execution down the path that we just went. And the reason that this is actually useful is because we can pick some of those assertions and flip them. And what this will actually allow us to do is solve the formula, getting another concrete input to the program, but now we know that input's actually going to take us down a different path through the program. So this is obviously very powerful because it allows us to target different parts of the program. The other nice thing that we can do with concolic execution is we can start to reason about properties on the path that we're looking at. So one of the things this program is doing is it's allocating some memory, and then it's writing into that allocated buffer. And this condition you see here at the bottom right of your screen is a condition that if it's true, there's actually a buffer overflow going on. And it turns out we can take these types of conditions as well, give them to tools called SMT solvers, and solve them. And in this case, if we solve one, we've basically found proof that we have a vulnerability here. Now, in contrast, with fuzzing, although it works very well, we have much less control. So with fuzzing, again, we also start with a concrete input. We do some kind of mutation. So that's kind of hard to see, but you know, basically we're doing this bit flipping or whatever mutation we're using. And we just kind of run it and we see what happens. We have very little control over where we're going. So you can see that these two types of techniques are really complementary. So with concolic execution, we have a lot of power. We have a lot of control. We can choose which parts of the program we'd like to go to. The downside is that it's very expensive and it's fairly slow. Fuzzing, on the other hand, is very fast. And when it works well, it's great. But when we have lots of complicated logic, sometimes it won't find its way into the right parts of the program. So again, they're very complementary techniques. And so our natural goal is basically to take them and put them together, right? Can we use the strengths of each one and try to avoid the weaknesses? And so that's what we've been doing with our collaborators from For All Secure. We've created a prototype tool that we call SMART, the Synergistic Mayhem AFL Research Tool, which basically takes a concolic executor, Mayhem, which has been developed by For All Secure. We've been working on it with them as well. And it takes a fuzzer called AFL, and it combines them. And what I mean by combine is it actually allows the two tools to take the seed files, that they know of, and basically send them back and forth to each other. And so essentially what this allows it to do is when fuzzing can't get to a certain part of the program, it'll start using concolic execution. And when concolic execution is too slow and it's not finding large parts of the program, then it allows fuzzing to do that work for it. So it's kind of a really natural idea. It turns out to be somewhat harder than we expected. There's two main challenges. So with concolic execution, we can kind of steer the process. But one of the problems is, where do we go? Before we start looking for these vulnerabilities, we don't necessarily know where they are. So we need to come up with some way to actually prioritize which parts of the program we should go to, which parts are more likely to have vulnerabilities. The second challenge is just that concolic execution is really, really slow. So we have to decide on scheduling. How much of our time should we be spending doing fuzzing versus doing concolic execution? And so we have some basic solutions to these, but we're far from solving those completely. The good news is that even though we haven't solved these challenges completely, we do have really good initial results. So what this graph is showing you is it's showing you something called edge coverage that we get after 2 days of testing. What edge coverage is it's a measure, you can think of it as a measure of how much of the program's logic you've covered or tested. And so down in the bars, the blue bar represents the coverage that we get from using Mayhem, the concolic testing tool, by itself. And the red bars are what we get out of our tool, SMART. And so the basic difference here is that our tool is also using Mayhem, but it's trying to intelligently employ fuzzing wherever it can at the same time. And what you can see is that, you know, even this is not a finished approach, we're still getting a lot better coverage than we do with just concolic execution. And so one way that you can think about this result is that Concolic execution is a great technique, but it's really hard to get to scale. And so part of what this project is doing is basically trying to speed it up enough so that we can use it in practice. So to wrap things up, we're trying to create new techniques and improve on existing techniques for finding vulnerabilities in software. I told you about some of our work to generate ground truth data that maps crashes back to the vulnerabilities that cause them, and how we can actually use that data to try to make fuzzing and vulnerability discovery into more of a science. And I've also talked about our work with For All Secure, where we combined fuzzing and concolic testing to try to improve our vulnerability discovery capabilities.